We turn to Iran, the target of former President Trump's so-called maximum pressure campaign aimed at crippling Tehran's economy. Now, President Biden is signaling a return to a nuclear deal, but also demanding an end to expanded nuclear work. Special correspondent Reza Sayah tells us how this is playing out in Iran.
When spring arrives in Iran, so does Nowruz, the Iranian New Year. Tehran's Tajri Square bustles with shoppers, haggling for traditional symbols of Nowruz: fish for life, eggs for fertility, flowers for rebirth and renewal. But what's hidden beneath the holiday festivities here is stress and hardship. U.S. sanctions are still choking an Iranian economy, already hampered by corruption and mismanagement. Fruit stand owner Behzad Mousavi says celebrating the new year is harder than ever.
This was the worst year, in my opinion. Not just for me, but for most people, this was the worst year.
Samira and her husband Vahid say the cost of living and raising two girls has never been so high.
During the past 1 or 2 years, prices have tripled and quadrupled. We're doing our best to get by, but we're not happy.
Despite the celebration that comes with the Persian New Year, there's little question that the U.S. sanctions and the maximum pressure campaign of former President Donald Trump has made millions of Iranians suffer. There's soaring inflation. Almost everything costs more. The value of the Iranian currency has plummeted. And some statistics show more than 1.5 million Iranians have fallen into poverty.
But beyond causing pain for ordinary Iranians, many here say the maximum pressure campaign has done little else.
It put a lot of pressure on people, but in my view, the U.S. didn't get any results.
The United States will withdraw.
The maximum pressure campaign against Iran began in 2018 when Mr. Trump pulled out of the Iran nuclear deal, also known as the JCPOA. In the agreement signed under then-President Barack Obama, the U.S. and world powers agreed to lift economic sanctions against Iran. In return, Iran rolled back its nuclear program, deemed a threat by the West. Mr. Trump said the deal wasn't enough. Sanctions and economic pressure, he said, would rein in what Washington calls Iran's destabilizing behavior in the region and curb its missile program. But today, Iran still funds, trains, and sometimes commands militias and proxy forces in Iraq, Syria, Lebanon, and Yemen, some accused of attacking U.S. interests and allies in the region. Iran also continues to expand its ballistic missile program, showing off its latest missiles at this military exercise earlier this year. Ray Takei was a State Department official working on Iran under President Obama, now at the Council on Foreign Relations. He was a fervent opponent of the deal.
The administration has promised that it will revisit critical aspects of the Iran nuclear deal, particularly expiration of the sunset clauses, the ballistic missiles that were excluded from the original deal, and Iran's so-called malign activity.
Trump's maximum pressure campaign failed utterly.
Tehran-based political analyst Mohammad Marandi says Iran's missiles are a necessary deterrent, not a pressure tactic against Washington.
Aren't they saying if you don't come back to the nuclear deal, this is what you can expect?
When the United States surrounds Iran with military bases, then the Iranians will send messages through its military maneuvers that one wrong move and you're in deep trouble. That's deterrence.
Some analysts say the maximum pressure campaign was also designed to trigger popular unrest and regime collapse, something the Trump administration had denied. In 2019, a sudden spike in fuel prices did spark nationwide protests. A deadly crackdown followed. A few weeks later, the protests ended. Today, there's little indication that Iranians have an appetite for an uprising. The maximum pressure campaign did succeed in intensifying a rift between Iran's moderates, led by President Hassan Rouhani, who made the nuclear deal a centerpiece of his 2017 re-election campaign, and anti-U.S. conservative factions, who were long suspicious of a pact with Washington. Abolfaz Amoui is one of those conservatives. He was part of the diplomatic team led by Iranian Foreign Minister Mohammad Javad Zarif that negotiated the nuclear deal. Today, he is among scores of newly elected conservative lawmakers who now dominate Iran's parliament. They call for a more confrontational approach to Washington. Last month, they threatened to bring legal action against President Rouhani, accusing him of circumventing Iranian law in his effort to restore the deal. But Amoui claims the two sides have now buried the hatchet and are united in their demands against Washington.
Nowadays, there is a very good cooperation between the, you know, between the administration and the parliament.
So no conflict between you and the president?
Nowadays, there is no conflict.
Nowadays?
Yes.
In its latest report, the UN's nuclear watchdog said Iran's stockpile of enriched uranium is roughly 15 times more than the limit set in the 2015 nuclear deal. In December, lawmakers voted to further expand Iran's nuclear program and scale back some nuclear inspections.
President Joe Biden says he's open to restoring the nuclear deal. Was it the right timing to pass a law restricting IAEA inspections?
If I want to explain the, you know, the logic of this law, it was designed to make pressure against the United States and other Western countries to implement their commitment through the JCPOA.
Do you think it's helping or hurting matters?
I think that it helped us.
President Joe Biden says he's open to restoring the nuclear deal. He says he wants to talk. Why not talk with Washington?
Did they talk to us for, you know, leaving or withdrawing from the JCPOA? If they want to come back, there's no need to talk to us.
I do think some way is going to be worked out where the two parties will return to the table, but there's little possibility of renegotiating it along the parameters that the United States has laid out. So down the road, I do think we're going to face another negotiating stalemate.
How much do you trust or mistrust the Biden administration?
There is a big mistrust wall between Iran and the United States.
At a time when Iranians celebrate a season of renewal, the decades-long mistrust between Washington and Tehran still lingers. The effects of the U.S. maximum pressure campaign persist, and a nuclear deal with global implications hangs in the balance. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Reza Sayah in Tehran.